WTOG Channel 44 Sports presents the eighth running of the Tampa Bay Derby, live from Tampa Bay Downs in Oldsmar, Florida. Today's race is being brought to you by Walker Ford. Remember, at Walker Ford, we mark them up just a little bit. And by Popeye's Famous Fried Chicken and Biscuits.
Everybody, and welcome to the biggest day of the year here at Tampa Bay Downs, the eighth running of the Tampa Bay Derby. Now, it's a grade 3 mile and 16th race that many people consider a stepping stone to the big ones, the Kentucky Derby, the Preakness, and perhaps the Belmont Stakes. And who better to help analyze an event of this magnitude than the man who's probably witnessed every start here at Tampa Bay Downs over the last few years, Graham Ross. Graham, now, it's an excellent day. A big day is going to be a big payday. Only one regret, no Regal Classic.
Well, Beasley, someone said a long time ago that racing is not a game for people in short pants. And by that, they meant just this kind of thing. Everybody's disappointed that Regal Classic could not make it, but coughing in the spring is part of young horses' lives. It's been going around the Sampson Farm barn. I feel very bad for the Sampson Farm people, but this horse can recover from this cough and still make the Kentucky Derby. And what that does with Regal Classic out is make our race a lot more competitive and turn it into a sort of a showcase event for Woody Stevens' up till now B string, and that is a horse by the name of Cephas.
All right, all the people are very, very excited here. It's a packed house. How many people in attendance?
Well, the last count I had was a few races ago, and we had over 7,300 people in then. With progressions being what they are, we would expect well over 8,000 for the crowd for the day, and that's an excellent crowd for us here.
All right, working the winner's circle today will be a man that I'll put my money on any day, and that's Stan Rhoads. Stan, would you set the scene for us down there?
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Beasley. And as Graham has said, there are very close to about 8,000 folks that are here right now. Beautiful day, about 67 degrees. The track is very solid. It could possibly be a chance to break the track record of 1 minute 43 and 4/5 seconds. We're going to be looking at that, and very shortly we'll be seeing if that might happen in the ninth race and, of course, in the Derby. Later on, we're going to be finding out some of the things that take place behind the scenes here at Tampa Bay Downs, and as well finding out some of the systems that people use to place their money on the line. Back to you, Beasley.
All right, we're about 5 minutes away from the first race of our telecast. So we'll take a break and return with plenty of action after this. Welcome back to the Downs, everybody. Beasley Reece here with Graham Ross to describe the action in the first race. Graham, first of all, who's going to win this one?
Well, you caught me on a bad race, Beasley. This is a wide open race. There's 9 horses in it, and I think five of them could win.
Okay, why don't you go down the list for me?
Okay, well, the first 4 from the rail out are all possibilities. Dr. M&S is coming off a loss. He stepped up in class a little last trip to the post. He's back where he belongs. He looks very good. He's got a late rider change, a David Nieder from Syracuse, New York. He is replacing William Henry, who was hurt earlier in the day, but just shaken up. He's quite all right. He's off his mounts for the day, but he'll be okay.
All right, what about Wingod?
Wingod is the speed in the race. He's going to be out there on the front end, and they'll be trying to catch him. If he gets loose on the lead, he's halfway home. But they'll keep the other riders behind him. We'll keep that in mind, and they'll be looking to catch up to him.
Right,
he's
Copper
ridden
Lander.
By Jose Rivera II.
Uh-huh, Copper Lantern.
Copper Lantern, a hard-hitting horse, ridden by our leading rider here at the Downs, Ronnie Allen Jr. Ronnie's broken all previous records here. He is personal goal set to win 100 races at the year. Going into today, he had 97 winners, so that seems assured.
All right, Gentle Ivor.
Gentle Ivor, another hard-hitting horse who is jumping up and down the claiming ladder. He looks back at the level where he can be a horse for serious consideration, ridden by Frank Panisi this afternoon.
Okay, I love the name of this next one, Umbo.
Well, you might love the name, Beasley, but that's about all you can love, because he's one of the ones I don't figure, which is just that you better run to the window, because that's usually the sign that they're going to win.
Well,
he'll be ridden this afternoon by Carl Burns.
I like the underdog all the time. All right, Stars Arab.
I don't foresee him as the winner. A little bit more of a chance than the one whose name you like, but Stars Arab, not too much of a chance today. Alberto Ramos, who's 50 years old, by the way.
All right, Tentum.
Tentum, another horse that could win it. Kevin Whitley aboard. I believe he's had two winners already today, and right there every time, and one of the horses that could win it all.
Rich Gift, will he live up to his name?
Rich Gift, if he does, it'll be at a big price, so in a way he will if he wins it. Terry Warner has the mount.
And First Pick, will he live up to his name?
First Pick would be my last pick, I think, except for maybe Ambo, whose name you like. Ronald Buchanan has the mount.
Okay, now what happens when you change riders? Does that affect the outcome very much? And when you lose a rider and have to throw another jockey in all of a sudden?
Well, it depends. If the jockey's ridden the horse before, it shouldn't have any effect at all. If he's a completely new rider or a relatively inexperienced rider, he might have some problems. An experienced rider, the trainer could tell him what the horse's habits are, and it shouldn't make too much of a difference anyway.
Okay, how about a prediction on time and your top two? Who do you think will come in one and two?
Well, let me see. Copper Lantern has been right there. He'll probably go to the post as the favorite. Let me say Copper Lantern with Dr. M&S a close second, and Tentum right behind him.
Okay, now the track record here once again at a mile and 16th is what?
It's 143.4. Uh-huh. And it's been tied earlier this year on February 27th by Home Builder, who incidentally is trained by Woody Stevens. It was tied last year by Phantom Jet in this race we're looking at today, and originally set by Dan Gelt back in 1959.
So we don't expect any times like that to come out of this particular
field. Not this particular field, but maybe the next one.
All right, then. I can see them. They're just about moving into the post now. We were talking about the change in the jockeys. That's going to affect a few things. But at this time, let's throw it up to the track announcer, Richard Grunder.
Waiting for Rich Gift and First Pick. First Pick now behind the gate. He steps in, and they're at the post. And they're off. Away and running in good order. From between horses, Wind God reaching up for the early lead with Copper Lantern there second. Up on the extreme outside is First Pick third. And the last horse away is Gentle Ivor. They make the charge to the first turn. Wind God is there toward the rail is shortly. Up on the outside, First Pick racing second. Dr. M&S is now third. Copper Lantern from between horses fourth. Ambo to the outside, three deep racing fifth. Gap of two lengths back. Gentle Ivor now skims the rail sixth. Tentham on the outside is seventh, Stars Arab, and far back is Rich Gift. The nine of them as they settle for their journey up the backstretch. First Pick on the outside, Buchanan sends him to the lead three parts of a length. Wind God is there second, three lengths farther back. Dr. M&S a bit closer third. Copper Lantern is fourth. Ambo up on the outside is fifth. General Ivor, he looks for racing room toward the rail sixth. Three lengths farther back, Stars Arab is seventh as they pass the half-mile marker. First Pick still commands the race. Wind God is there toward the rail, second ahead. Dr. M&S now charging up on the outside, third. Copper Lantern, Allen now puts into the drive, fourth. Ambo on the outside is fifth. General Ivor tucked in toward the rail, sixth. Midway in the turn, Dr. M&S on the outside. Driving up now to collar the leader. First Pick back to second. General Ivor in a charge, three deep for the drive, third. Wind God is now fourth. Two lengths farther back. From between horses, Copper Lantern is now fifth. They turn into the stretch. General Ivor on the outside. Panisi now sends him up to gain the lead. Dr. M&S giving up the battle second. Three lengths farther back. Wind God on the outside is third. Extreme outside. Here's a length run by Tentham. But in the final 16th of a mile, General Ivor, he has this field and going away. In deep stretch, it's General Ivor. Much the best with Wind God second and a photo for third.
Once again, you see why they call it gambling. Now, Graham, you call 317, and as we see Gentle Ivor going across the line with a runaway victory, how do things like that happen?
Well, I'll cover myself a little bit. I did say five horses could win it, and one of the five I said could win it did win it. That's about all I can say, Beasley. It was a wide open race, and the horse that was second, Wind God, I also liked him, so in a way, I'm doing all right.
Yeah, that you are. That you, certainly better than I would do. As we see the champion there trotting before us now, he's got to be a happy jockey right now as he will be making his way back around to the winner's circle. Right now he's the unofficial winner, and we are waiting for those official results as we see him bolting with jockey standing high above the mount, above his steed, heading back to the winner's circle. Our right, here's the replay. Graham, why don't you take us through the stretch here?
Well, yeah, Panisi's pretty well got the race run here. He switched his stick into his right hand here, and now he just seems to have moved into his left here. So he's just about drawing off from the rest of the crowd. He's already got the race won. The race at this point is for second. You'll see Wingod coming along in the white hat outside the horse in second. With the blinkers on, the orange blinkers, he's going to get second money just by a short margin.
All right, we see him coming on in for the victory. The easy victory in the ninth race. Now we have 12 on the card, right? Let's take a look at this view. Now this is an interesting view.
This is the head-on shot. This is something the public doesn't usually see. We like to show it because a lot of times what you see on a pan shot will not indicate the kind of cutting and cross, the kind of bumping a horse could be involved in. You just don't see it on a wide angle with a pan shot, but the head-on shows it to you.
There's the winner down there in the winner's circle. Now, this is the ninth race of a 12-card day. And it should be much, much more excitement as we take to see the jockey releasing his horse of the saddle. And we'll take a look at the history of this racetrack and the history of this area after this. Downs, everybody. Graham, we've got the official results and the payoffs. Can you take us through that?
Yes. Well, the winner, as you know, is number 4, Gentle Ivor. All payoffs at the racetrack, Beasley, are composed on a basis of a $2 wager. So number 4, Gentle Ivor, to win pays $10.40. To place, to finish second, he pays $4.40. And to finish third, he pays $3.80 for show. That means when you bet, for instance, the second horse, Wingod, if you bet him to place or show, you do get your ticket. As you can see, he pays $4.20 to place and $3.80 to show if you only bet him to come in third. And the third horse, number 6, Stars Arab, pays $7.60 to show.
All right, excellent. Thanks a lot for that. You know, those of us who live around the area know a little bit about the racetrack, but there's a very interesting history that surrounds the Downs. Let's take a look at that. Time is 1915 and people are flocking to the Sunshine State for the real estate rush. One man has his eye on the north end of Tampa Bay. He's Ransom E. Olds, founder of Oldsmobile. His plan is to develop a new city designed for people of modest means. The city is to be laid out like the spokes of a wheel to include industrial and residential areas. Farmland, hotels, a golf course, and a racetrack. Mr. Olds was able to bring industry to the area, but by the early 20s, he began to liquidate his holdings. Like the city, the racetrack would change hands several times before being put to rest by the Depression.
The sign in the window of the old City Hall building is a stark reminder that not much is left from the early days. The fortunes of the city and the racetrack seem to parallel one another, but Ransom Old's dream of a city would be realized, as would his racetrack.
It wasn't until 1947 that the track would reopen as Sunshine Park. This time with a tote board, photo finish camera, and an electric starting gate. In 1965, the track was purchased by a group of Tampa sportsmen headed by Chester Ferguson and renamed Florida Downs. In 1980, New York Yankees owner George Steinbrenner became part owner with Ferguson's daughter, Stella Ferguson Thayer, as the track was renamed Tampa Bay Downs. Now wholly owned by Mrs. Thayer, the track and related facilities is one of the largest in the country, and like the city of Oldsmar, doing quite well nestled away north of Tampa Bay. All right, a very rich history indeed. Let's go down to the winner's circle and check in with Stan Rhoads.
Thank
Thank you very much, Beasley. Like most businesses, including television, it takes many people behind the scenes to make things work, and that is the same here for horse racing. Of course, we see the audience and the people here who are participating, the jockeys and so forth, but there are many, many people that make it possible, such as groomers, hot walkers, etc. So right now, let's take a moment and go behind the scenes here at Tampa Bay Downs.
Start getting your horses ready to go to the racetrack. A lot of work to it all day long.
Some horses accept you the minute you walk in the stall. Generally, if you're feeding them, you're okay, you know, like all animals, like your dog or your cat. Others, it'll take you a long time, take as much as a month of them, you know, learning to trust you, feeling you out, you feeling them out, and letting them know how much they can get away with. It's just like raising a kid.
I'm a hot walker. Well, he walks hot horses that come after the race. He cools them out. So I've done this practically all my adult life. Didn't have these walking machines then. And I never thought that I would be replaced by a machine. Never could imagine it. That's always a thrill when you ride a good horse. You ride a horse that really tries. I rode a lot of cheap horses that try real hard, and they're fun to ride. You travel all the time because it's a seasonal occupation. It's a seasonal business. Everybody involved has to travel. It's a different life. You know, it's 365 days a year. You don't get too much of a break. Every now and then you might manage to take a week off if you're lucky. Because horses have to be fed and so forth and cared for. And it's just a year-round job, but it's a lot of fun.
Just some of the many folks that make it possible here at Tampa Bay Downs. And right now, we'll go back to Beasley and Graham.
All right, thanks a lot, Stan. Listen to this. $41,056,148 moved about the Downs last year. That was the total mutual handle. Now, Channel 44's Jay Vilwalk will take a look at the money after this. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the board. As you see the approximate odds right now, you can see that some of the favorites are the one horse and five and the six horse coming up. Also, the eight horse, Sir Al, getting a few nods. Okay, there you see it. Now, of course, that board reflects one of the main activities that goes on around here, and that is the wagering, the placing of the bets. Here's Jay Vilwalk.
So you want to go to the races, eh? Well, get ready for everybody's race story. About the trifecta that got away, or the quinella that flopped before the finish, the winners, the losers, the also-rans.
I lose so I can come back and see if I can find it. I always miss it by that much, you know?
I won $360. $3.60. That's it.
$2 a race. That's, you can't get hurt. That's all I bet. $2 a race. Right?
Try to win as much as you can.
Is that winning?
Yeah, big deal. This is the
this is the
How
best way to
win?
Go.
Seriously.
So far, I hit this trifecta. I hit the other trifecta.
You're kidding, really?
I'm serious.
So how much you won? About?
Right now, about 300.
That'll be all.
Wide eyes, flared nostrils, pumping muscles. And that's just the spectators. Oh, yeah, sometimes they get carried away. All in a day at the races. But then there's always tomorrow.
I got the horse! Right here.
The great horses that run here at the Downs and other tracks are the product of hours of love and attention. Now, there are some excellent farms that call this area home. Let's take a look at one of those, Samson Farms in Ocala. Samson Farms in the heart of horse country, they've got a 160-acre facility, including their own racetrack. Now, about 40 people make their living here, and it costs around $2 million a year to run this operation. But that doesn't guarantee you a winner.
I think there aren't any real tricks involved, Beasley, with training horses. I think it's a long, slow, tedious process, just like developing any other athlete for any other sport. But it's real important to somehow as a trainer to get your hands on a top quality animal with, that's been blessed with great racing potential and real good nerves. That doesn't really mean that he's going to be a good one, because once they get to what we call the iron lung, which is a starting gate, they're all the same, and they leave there, and now it's, you know, it's one horse against 10 or 10 other horses, and it's a head-and-head situation, and really boils down to their, you know, their racing instinct, their desire just to be better than the competition. We've developed a kind of a routine here at Samson Farm that is a little bit different than most North American trainers would have. We're based out of Toronto in Ontario. We race at Woodbine as our home base, and from there we can race anywhere in North America. But I like the idea of coming here to the farm in late November, early December, and we bring our older horses that have been racing all year, and we kind of freshen them up. And then we're also, it acts as our spring training camp for our two-year-olds. And then by the time we leave here towards the end of March, you know, our old horses are hopefully freshened up and ready to go back to competition again. And the two-year-olds, we've got a pretty good line on them, so we kind of have an idea where to start spotting them through the summer races, hopefully starting sometime in June or July.
Everybody, welcome back to Tampa Bay Downs for the eighth running of the Tampa Bay Derby. Let's go to the winner's circle and check in with Stan Rhoads.
All righty, thank you, Beasley. When you think about systems, everybody has a system, whether it be going to the grocery store and heading down aisle one and then two and three, waiting for that milk and, of course, the meats later on. But here we're talking about betting systems, and we've got some ideas. You might just find in, perhaps in common, let's find out about these bizarre betting systems.
My system is to take what you can afford to lose and have some fun. And if you think you're going to make money on the horses, I'm going to tell you, no, I don't think you will.
Once in a while, my daughter's name's on one of the horses, Lisa, so we played that one. No, nothing scientific.
I take the first three numbers off my $10 bill or dollar bill. That's my system.
We've been here for one race, and we've accumulated about six losing tickets already. So I wouldn't want to share this system with the world, let alone Tampa Bay.
Now, the racing form will give you all the horses that run in the race, and you can look at them, and you can try to figure out who's going to win the race. But that's not going to do you any good. You got to have some horse sense.
My wife's got a better system.
I play the kids' names and birthdays.
I give points for each line and speed rating and everything else.
add them up, and whoever has the biggest number goes to the horses, whichever couple of horses have the biggest number.
We look for some good jockeys. They get good horses lots of times. We look for good trainers, and we look for horses that look good and walking good.
I can't tell by looking at them. Damn few people can.
There you go, when it's here today, Jack's the clock.
The guy tells you he wins all the time, he's lying. Nobody wins all the time by the horses.
I like to pick winners, and I pick winners, and I'm out here, and I'm making me some money.
Well, I ain't had none in about 4 or 5 weeks now.
By the grace of the Lord, and pick a number.
It's about all you can do, and pray.
I've been playing the horses over 75 years, and I don't have my second million yet. I'm still trying.
All righty. Now, another thing, I happened to run into a man, Beasley, that said, you raced horses. And I said, wait a minute, Beasley doesn't race horses. He said, no, he races horses. I said, what do you mean? Well, we found some video of Beasley, of you, Beasley, racing a harness race horse. What is this all about? Horses and racing,
Stan,
huh?
Stan, that was a long time ago. I don't even recognize that young sprinter moving down the track right now.
And you won to boot. How about that?
And I beat him by a nose. That was at Monticello Raceway years ago. They called the Giants, and they asked them for the fastest man on the team. So you know who they sent, Stan.
Well, how about that? Congratulations to you, Beasley, for winning and beating a racehorse. Back to
all
you,
right,
Beasley.
Thanks a lot, buddy. All right, Graham Ross will join me in a few minutes when we return from this break, and we'll talk about the odds, the favorites. We're moments away from the big derby. We'll see you in a minute. Everybody, welcome back to the Downs. You are looking at the odds board, and back with me is Graham Ross to tell you what those numbers mean. Graham, why don't you take us through the board and tell us how the betting is going so far.
Well, Beasley, at the present time, the number one horse, twice too many, is at 10 to 1. Mm-hmm. That means he would pay $22 on a $2 wager. The number two horse is our house horse, House Account. And he's presently at 7 to 2. That means he'll pay $9 on a $2 wager. He's easily the second choice in the wagering behind Woody Stevens or Cephas right now. The number three horse, Buck Forbes, the invader from Northern Kentucky, is presently at 6 to 1 and the third choice in the wagering. The fourth horse, Space Walker, second in the Sam F. Davis Stakes, final prep for this event, is presently right now at 10 to 1. The five horse, Tight Halo, one of two supplementary nominees in the race, is not so highly regarded by the fans. He's 45 to 1. And the number six horse, of course, is Cephas, owned by the Rye Hill Farm and Robert Kirkham, and trained by the legendary Woody Stevens and ridden by Ed Maple. He's 3 to 5 at the present time. That's odds on. That's less than even money. That means for a $5 wager, you would get back $8. For a $2 wager, you would get back either $3.40 or $3.60.
Okay, now we've got the number one horse on the camera now coming down the track as they move around. That's twice too many. Tell me a little bit about twice too many.
Twice too many ran a very bad race last time, and I just won, or not the last time, but the time before that in the Florida Derby. I hate to think he ran that badly, because if you throw that race out, he has a little bit of a chance. He's ridden by Santiago Soto from Santiago, Chile.
Okay, what about House Account?
House Account is easily the second choice in the race. He won the Sam F. Davis Stakes here locally. He's had 4 wins over this racetrack, and he'll be ridden by Dean Coutts.
All right,
number
Buck
three,
Forbes.
Buck Forbes is the invader from Northern Kentucky. He's coming off 2 wins in a row, and he'll be ridden by the Panamanian Sebastian Madrid.
All right, what about Spacewalker,
number four? Spacewalker. This is the horse that finished second to House Account in the Sam F. Davis, and he's ridden by Frank Panisi, who just won this last race, and is from Brooklyn, New York.
All right, then let's go to the number five horse, Tight Halo. He seems to be a long shot favorite.
Tight Halo is a supplementary nomination, and he's being disregarded by the public. He's trained by Glenn Wismer, a perennial leading trainer here. His brother, Norman Wismer, won the trainer's title last year. He'll be ridden by Rick Adkins.
All right, what about the great Cephas?
The Cephas. This is his coming out party. He either joins the real list of notables to the Derby or he does not. Eddie Maple, a regular rider for Woody Stevens, will be in the irons and is shipped in for the mount.
All
All right. Will RO's treat be a threat?
RO's threat is the other supplementary nomination. Trained by Eduardo Garcia, ridden by Willie Rodriguez, who was rode here many years ago. He left in the last few years and has been back here this year. Willie was born in Havana, Cuba, but has resided in the United States for some time.
Sir Al.
Sir Al, big question mark in this race. He comes in, he's just changed hands. He's got a new trainer, Art Pedregal, one of our good trainers from the area. He's from Tampa Bay area. He's ridden by Constantino Hernandez. I'd like to say he's from Constantino, Spain, but he's not. He's from Salamanca, Spain.
And finally, Climb High.
Climb High, probably not too well regarded in the wagering. No, not at the present time. He's ridden by, owned by T.G. Driscoll, trained by L.W. Lockhart, and will be ridden by, though, by our leading rider, Ronnie Allen Jr.
All right, now, House Account has won four out of his last starts here at the Downs. If I'm not correct, please correct me.
That's correct.
Does that have anything to do with his, I mean, will familiarity, knowing his surroundings, how will that help him in this race?
Well, I think that's a good question, Beasley, and especially so here. This racetrack is known as one that's good for horses for courses. And there's no question that House Account is a horse for this course. He has won four times in his life, and all four of his victories have been here, including that most impressive win in the Sam Davis last time out.
All right, we've had a little rain in the area. How is the track, and will that affect the times?
Well, the rain that we had in the area has since long left the racetrack. The track is fast now. I don't know what we could expect in the way of a record time today. I just let those things, it depends on the pace of the race going into it as to whether we would set a track record today. But rain is not in the picture. As you can see, there's not a cloud in the sky. And so this is not a race where you're looking for a horse that loves the mud.
All right, now what about the possibility of a track record being set here?
Well, I'd like to think you always hope for one. The track has been relatively fast today, but it was a little dead earlier in the day from the rain, so we may or may not see one this afternoon.
All right, as we see the people milling around here, we're about a minute or two away from the Derby. Let's take a look at the history, some of the past winners of this race. Jockey David Ashcroft, riding Paristo, edges out Braves to Fall to win the inaugural running of the Tampa Bay Derby. Paristo goes on to win the Illinois Derby and finish third in the 81 Preakness. 6 years ago today, jockey Rick Luhr atop Reinvested wins the Derby. Reinvested goes on to finish third in the Kentucky Derby. Morgan, 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 ridden by William Rodriguez, leads Slew a Gold to the wire for the first $100,000 Tampa Bay Derby. But Slew a Gold goes on to be a leading candidate for Horse of the Year honors. In the fourth running, jockey Wayne Cruz atop Bold Southerner battles it out with Rexon's Hope to Win and beats the Derby record by almost a second. In 1985, Regal Remark with jockey Jeff Fell wins the Derby. Owned by Samson Farms and trained by Jim Day, Regal Remark was sired by Vice Regent, who also sired Regal Classic. My Prince Charming with jockey Craig Perrette holds off Lucky Ribault to win on the wet track. A year later, My Prince wins the inaugural Tampa Bay Budweiser Breeders' Cup with the exact same time. Last year, Keith Allen and Phantom Jet outran Homebuilder and tied the track record to hold the latest crown as winner of the Tampa Bay Derby. All right, there you saw the past history of this great race. We'll find out who the 1988 champion will be for the eighth running of the Tampa Bay Derby after this. Welcome back to the Downs, everybody. With me is Graham Ross. Graham, let's talk about the two big horses once again in this particular fight.
Well, first of all, Beasley, I do want to emphasize that
this is, I refer to this as Cephas's coming out party, and by that I mean it's his coming out party for most everybody in the country, maybe even Woody Stevens. Everybody has seen 49er. He's been all over the place. He was the two-year-old champion. He was Woody Stevens' big horse going into this Triple Crown event. Very few people have seen Cephas, and even those that have been down at Gulfstream Park have seen Cephas run over the grass course. That's a little different. His last two victories have been on the grass, or his last two races have been on the grass. He has finished second both times in stakes company, but to make up a lot of lengths in the late going in a grass test is a lot easier than it is to make up a lot of lengths in the late going over a sandy track like Tampa Bay Downs. He's gonna have to have a lot of late run to get there, and if he does get there, then I think that shows that Cephas is really one of the premier candidates for the Triple Crown races.
All right, that's one of the things that will be decided today as we see the names, the first five contenders. Let's talk about the number two horse now, House Account.
House Account, Beasley, certainly. He's already proven himself here. There's another old adage in racing that you can't bet a horse on what he hasn't done. And one of the things Cephas hasn't done is race over this racetrack. He has not been a mile and a 16th in recent times. He was third in the Flamingo. That's a different racing surface at Hialeah. And those kind of people that follow that kind of wagering philosophy would be better off betting on House Account, who has certainly proven himself here. House Account was even here as a two-year-old, you know, and won our juvenile stakes here last spring, about a year ago, by 12 lengths. That was as a two-year-old. So you know he loves this racetrack.
Okay, now from the way people are betting, from the way you are talking as a person that has watched racing over the years, it would be a tremendous upset if somebody else was to come out of the pack and knock those two horses right off the block.
Well, having talked about only those two horses, I'll reverse myself immediately.
You better
say
that
there's nine horses in the race, and that means that there could be nine winners.
All right, folks, we are only a few minutes, we are moments away from the big race. Let's give it to the track announcer, Richard Grunder.
The field is now entering the starting gate. A field of nine going postward for this year's Tampa Bay Derby. At post time, the overwhelming favorite, number six, Cephas, from the Hall of Fame trainer, Woody Stevens Barn. Waiting for Sir Al and Climb High. Climb High now behind the gate. He steps in and we're ready to go for the eighth running of the Tampa Bay Derby. And they're off. Away and running in perfect order. House Account reaching up for the early lead with Buck Forbes second up on the outside. There goes Climb High. Moving up to challenge, and Cephas is the last horse away. They make the charge to the clubhouse turn. House Account, Coots now sends him to the lead. Up on the outside, Climb High now racing along second. Length and a half farther back. Buck Forbes tucked in along the rail third, three parts of length. Sorrel to the outside racing fourth. Arrow's Threat is there, fifth ahead. Toward the rail twice, thanks, too many racing sixth. Four lengths farther back, Space Rocker racing along seventh. Tight Halo up on the outside eighth. And Cephas, he is far back and probably 25 lengths off the leader. They settle for their journey up the backstretch. Climb High bearing out with the lead. House Account is there racing second up on the outside. Sorrel now moves to challenge third. Buck Forbes down along the inner rail fourth. Length and a half farther back, twice as hot, twice too many is now fifth. Up on the outside, Arrow's Threat racing sixth. They swing around the far turn. Up on the outside, Sorrel with House Account moving back gamely to challenge. There goes Buck Forbes now shooting through toward the rail. A bit closer now to be third. Up on the outside, twice too many is fourth. They approach the quarter mile pole. That's Buck Forbes. Madrid now sends him the lead by three. House Account racing second. Twice too many. Gaining ground up on the outside third. They turn into the stretch. Buck Forbes is the leader. Twice too many. Up on the outside racing second. House Account is third. Cephas Maple now has him in charge. Still 6 lengths off the leader. Inside the final furlong. Buck Forbes the leader. With twice too many. And Cephas, he's absolutely fine.
that something? Isn't that something? And Cephas passed his coming out test, Beasley. You can see that here today. Look at this horse with his late run. What chance would you have given for him to get there going when he went into the first turn? I tell you, this
if I'd
really
have had
something.
A ticket on Cephas from the beginning of this race, I would have torn it up before they even made the turn.
Isn't this something?
It is a beautiful thing to watch. A true champion. I think this is a horse we need to keep our eyes on for the future when it comes to the big races.
We got a publication in our office the other day that already has picked Cephas as this publication's pick for the Kentucky Derby. And today, they must have sold a million copies.
Well, you saw it here first, ladies and gentlemen. Take a look at a true champion making up incredible ground to cross the wire as you see it right there. Graham, that was phenomenal.
Isn't that something? You know, Chris McCarron, when Woody Stevens had won his fifth Belmont, Chris McCarron rode that fifth winner and came back and said, Woody, you're amazing. There's times like this, I gotta look at Woody and I say, Woody, you are amazing. You now, proved it here.
This is an interesting view, although this takes away from some of the drama from this head-on shot. It's hard to tell, you know, exactly how much ground this horse made up, but it's still.
We've seen it already on the pan shot, so I think most of those viewing today have already seen what he does. This tells you, though, which horses were staggering, which horses were getting in or getting out.
All right, if we can, let's try to run that thing back and take a look at that race, and especially keying into the beginning. Take it, Graham.
Well, you see two horses get away kind of poorly. They're both the five horse and Cephas both got away badly. So Cephas is content just to trail by many here going into the first turn. Now, as you can see, he's far behind the rest of the pack. They're all fighting for the lead. And you can see that nine horse on the outside of the leader there just going, but he gets around and into the backstretch and he's gonna start climbing. He's gonna head toward the outside fence right here. And you can see the rider, Ronnie Allen Jr., he's trying to keep him in, but this horse is out of his control. It's not the rider's fault, let me emphasize that. This horse is just running away with him. He's trying to get him back in the hunt and he's having his troubles. In the meantime, the race is all going on inside of him.
What a beautiful sight. He is still not even in the picture. A tremendous comeback victory for Cephas. What a coming out
party. And you can hear how the crowd loves it here. They're all applauding Cephas. They're all applauding Woody Stevens. And they're all applauding Eddie Maple, who had to have a lot of confidence.
You know, we can show you the pictures, but we cannot recreate the tension, the excitement before and during, and then especially in those closing moments. It's too bad that the people aren't here with us.
That's one of the beauties of being at the racetrack, Beasley. It's a great place to be. It's a wonderful afternoon in the sunshine, and I highly recommend it to those that have thought about coming but haven't been yet.
All right, let's take a look at this final stretch one more time. It certainly warrants another
look.
This
is Buck Forbes still on the lead. Now, this is a legitimate horse shipping down here from Northern Kentucky, Turfway Park. He looks to be home, but here comes Cephas.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
You got to give some credit to Eddie Maple, too, for knowing that he had something left to get there.
All right, let's take a look at the unofficial finish.
Okay, as you can see, that's Cephas, number one. Number second was the horse that was leading up the last few strides. That was Buck Forbes.
All right, folks, let's take it down to Stan Rose. I believe he's got Woody Stevens with him. Stan?
Yes, he's right now with Cephas right now. Well, Woody, what do you think about this?
I like what I saw. Is that right?
He's running around right now. He's extremely happy. What's
you guys got the
what's the plans for Cephas right now? Giving up for the Derby. Well, he's apparently kind of busy and happy with what's going on here, so we're trying to get the pictures taken. And we're going to get him move out of the way for that. And we'll let that take care. He's very happy. He said he wanted to talk to his folks down in Miami and find out how 49er has done today. And that might change the ranking between Cephas and 49er. Try and get a word in with him, but we'll go back to Beasley right now.
All right, thanks a lot, Stan. Graham, why don't you wrap this thing up? That was an incredible finish. And Woody Stevens down there attending his number two horse. I'm sure
this may move up in the ranking. I mean, I don't know how you can move up above 49er, but this was quite a showing by that young
one. One of the questions I wish I could ask Woody, and maybe Stan will get the chance, is how does this horse compare to 49er right now after today? Certainly, the key phrase that happened here today is Cephas is right smack in the middle of the Triple Crown picture as of this afternoon.
Well, without question, he will definitely be. He takes my vote. I mean, I am thoroughly impressed. It was a very exciting finish. I tell you what, you think we've got Woody down there? Okay, Stan, let's go back down to Stan.
All right, thank you, Beasley. Yes, we do. We have Woody Stevens with us. Let me ask you again, what do you think of this race today with Cephas?
I like what I see. This is going to make me a great mile and a quarter, mile and a half horse. And this short stretch, the way he made up ground today, that 5/16th of a mile stretch at Louisville, is very tempting.
Certainly was. The crowd, you could just hear the anticipation, excitement as he came on. Now, I didn't get quite a good answer from you as yet because you were working with a horse. What do you think now between Cephas and 49er?
Well, 49ers is a real speed horse. We don't know yet if he can get the mile and a quarter, but he was champion two-year-old, and I love him, and I love the horse that Digress that's in Miami in about 10 minutes, and I have three awfully nice three-year-olds.
All righty. Thank you very much, Woody. Congratulations to you. Back to you, Beasley.
All right. Thanks, Stan. Thanks a lot. I appreciate that, and thanks to Mr. Stevens for giving us that time to talk. Graham, that was something else.
It's all Cephas, but not to take away. Not to take away from some of the other horses in the race. I think they all ran creditably.
That did it. Now, what about the time? 1:44.2. Is that a correct time?
It's a very respectable time. It's a little bit off the track record, but speed is only important when you're in jail. I mean,
All right, folks, we've got a lot of people to thank. This was an excellent day. Let's say the thank you to owner Stella Ferguson Thayer for being so kind and gracious to the 44 sports team. Lorraine King, the general manager, did an excellent job giving us everything that we needed out here. And also, Graham, to your assistant, Debbie Hahn, is that right?
Debbie Hahn, she is my assistant.
Debbie Hahn?
And she's been a blessing this year.
I want to tell you from the 44 team that you guys have been wonderful. We thank you for this opportunity to broadcast the race. A new champion has been crowned. We hope you've enjoyed watching. For Stan Rhoads, for Graham, and the rest of the crew, thanks for watching.
Today's race has been brought to you by Walker Ford, where we mark them up just a little bit, and by Popeye's famous fried chicken and biscuits. Presentation of WTOG Channel 44 Sports, a 20-year tradition in Tampa Bay television.